Geology fans, we have now met all our main characters in the igneous rocks, but we need to look at the major patterns these rocks appear within, their context. In this episode, we will explore the large-scale igneous features that will add another dimension to our information bombs. Starting below ground, the intrusive igneous rocks start as masses of magma that freeze underground as massive bodies, sometimes the size of small countries. Speaking of country, we call the rocks our magma intrudes into as the country rock. If the magma enters country rock and freezes into a solid, we can name the solid body based on its size and shape. The general term for all these bodies are plutons, and the largest of all the plutons is called a batholith. If a pluton gets exposed at the surface and covers more than 100 square kilometers, about 40 square miles, we call it a batholith, a name literally meaning a deep rock. If the exposed pluton is under 100 kilometers squared, we call it a stock. Both batholiths and stocks are fed from below and almost always are intermediate to felsic in composition, as the low viscosity and usually higher temperature mafic magmas have an easier time escaping to the surface. Many of the smaller bodies get their magma from what are known as feeder dikes, which we will meet in a moment. And like sebaceous glands below your skin that can erupt to the surface causing a pimple, so the Earth can get a pimple when the magma is injected near the surface where the pressure can deform the overlying rocks into a blister. This blister, or pimple, when it freezes is called a laccolith, a lake rock, or reservoir rock. In shape, morphology, we say it is lenticular, in the general shape of a lentil, or lens. Laccoliths, too, tend to be intermediate to felsic in origin. The last common form, the lopolith, is the only one that commonly has mafic rocks. The lopolith is lenticular, like the laccolith, but has a depressed central region instead of doming the rocks above it. And lopolith means a shell stone or a basin stone. Though we often imagine these bodies as large, homogeneous masses, plutons often take on a layered appearance for a couple of reasons. Referring back to episode 14 on Bowen's reaction series, we know that silicate minerals come out of a melt in a specific order, with the ferromagnesian minerals falling out first and sinking to the bottom of the magma chamber, the intermediate minerals falling out on top of these, and the felsic minerals settling out last on very top. This can give a layered appearance to an exposed pluton, but the exposed part is key to another apparent layering. We mentioned previously that to have an intrusive igneous rock at the surface, it requires uplift and erosion. During those processes, cracks known as joints and faults can develop to give structure to the pluton. And there are even cracks that develop perpendicular to the pressure that the overburden used to have on that pluton. Now that the overburden has eroded away, the pluton, in a sense, remembers that former pressure and is pushing up against nothing, and it can pop the rock, causing what we call exfoliation domes, such as these that we see in Yosemite. The cracks may look like a kind of onion layering, but it's really pressure release fractures. Besides the blobby and blister-shaped plutons, we can have cylindrical vents and sheets like dikes and sills. All lava flows at the surface are fed by a vent or a dike. The vents have basically cylindrical or circular shapes that intersect the surface in circular patterns. The dikes are tabular in shape, that is, they have two long dimensions and one short, giving them an overall sheet appearance. Sills are also tabular in shape, and we distinguish between sills and dikes by the way they cut across the country rock. If the country rock has layers, and our tabular igneous body cuts across those layers, not parallel, we call it a dike. We could say a dike is discordant with the country rock's structure. Conversely, if the igneous intrusive rock body is tabular and concordant, that is, parallel with the country rock layers, we call it a sill. We can almost think of a sill as an underground lava flow running along the bedding planes. Both sills and lava flows often are fed by dikes, which we call feeder dikes. But we can tell a sill from a lava flow. One way we distinguish is crystal size, as sills are coarser grain than lava flows. We can also look for something we call a baked zone, where the magma body dumps heat into the surrounding rock and alters the country rock without melting it, bakes it. Because the heat to bake the country rock comes from the outer surfaces of the magma body, there is also a chill zone in the igneous body where smaller crystals line the edge of the Pluton, and the crystals get larger towards the center of the Pluton and smaller towards the edge. A sill, underground, will bake the rock both above it and below it. A lava flow will bake the rock below it, but there is nothing but air above it, so it can't have a baked zone on top. We also see more bubbles or vesicles in lava flows that have reached the surface and had their confining pressure released, like opening a soda can, while a sill is like a soda under pressure that's kept its bubbles in solution as the magma froze, so few to no bubbles in a sill. Dikes are usually more resistant to erosion than country rock at the surface and stand out as linear ridges. The same is true for vents and pipes and sills. The more circular-shaped conduits for magma to the surface will result in some interesting features. Sitting somewhere between intrusive and extrusive, volcanic plugs are formed from more resistant igneous rock which froze in the central vent of a volcano and which erodes away more slowly than the volcanic flanks of truly extrusive material. The neck of the volcano can resist erosion to remain behind as a striking example of differential erosion and symbol of extraterrestrial encounters. Forget extraterrestrial, let's just deal with extrusive right now. When magma reaches the surface, we can get lava flows, which fall into two broad categories based on their relative viscosity. These flows are much more common on the mafic end, where the lava can flow, and though still present at the felsic end, lava flows give way to pyroclastics, fragmented ejecta, when silica content and thus viscosity of the magma increases. When a magma is first ejected onto the surface as lava, it has a relatively high temperature and dissolved gas content, which helps it have a lower viscosity and run freely as the surface of the lava freezes into a crust, which gets wrinkled and finally freezes through into a pattern we call smooth and ropey. This type of lava is known as Pahoehoe. But as the lava flows downhill, it cools and expels dissolved gases, making it more and more viscous. As viscous lava finds resistance to running freely, it begins to freeze blocks at its surface that get jumbled together in a jagged, rough, and blocky surface. This is what we call lava. Because lava flows cool from the top down and thus contract from the top down, they start cracking at their tops, and these cracks propagate downward into the base of the lava flow, in the process making columns that break from each other without moving relative to each other. If a break in a rock has relative movement, we call it a fault, but these breaks with no relative movement are called joints. And as lava flows make joints, which turn a solid lava flow into a series of columns, this is called columnar jointing, and is a rather reliable way to tell a lava flow layer from a sedimentary layer from a distance. There is a possibility for a lava flow to cool from the bottom up instead, as when it runs over a wetland or stream. The water turning to steam below the flow can cause the lava to freeze and break in a tumultuous way and result in the feature we actually call a tumulus. When you look at these from the right perspective, you really understand why it's called a tumulus. Remaining at the surface, but stepping away from lava flows, we see the fragmented ejecta which coalesce to make our pyroclastic rocks. These come mainly from ash clouds that rain down on an area, or the larger cousins of ash, lapilli, cinders, and bombs, which accumulate closer and closer to the volcanic source as the ejecta gets larger and larger. Ash, being the smallest pyroclast, can actually travel all the way around the world. Now, some of the close-to-the-source pyroclastics come from the most deadly volcanic manifestation, the pyroclastic flow. It can kill you with heat, impact, or suffocation, but when it finally settles down, it can also fuse around you into a volcanic tuff if we have pure ash, or a volcanic breccia if we see larger angular fragments frozen within. And pyroclastic flows make for a killer ending this week as we round off our discussion of the igneous rocks. When we come back next time, we will move on around the rock cycle and begin our investigation of the sedimentary rocks, the layered pages of our planet, here on Earth Explorations.